Motor Car Company and its distributors and dealers everywhere present the Packard Hour. With Charles Butterworth, Johnny Green, his piano, and his orchestra. And starring... Fred Astaire.
No ties to my affections, I'm fancy free, I'm free for anything fancy. No dates, I can't be broken, no words, I can't be spoken, especially when I am feeling romantic. Like a robin that's on a tree, like a sailor that goes to sea, like an unwritten melody, I'm free, that's me. So bring on the big attraction, my decks are cleared for action, I'm fancy free, I'm free for anything fancy.
I'm very happy to be starting my series on the Packard Hour, and first of all, I'd like to give special thanks to those who so kindly took over the opening program last week. Ginger Rogers, she was swell. And Mary Livingston, she was swell. Alan Jones, he was swell. And Francia White, she was swell. And I want particularly to thank... Oh, Johnny, well, what's the name of that fellow who kept trying to get a car? Benny Rubin. John Bunny. What's the matter? Jack Benny.
Yeah, that's right, Jack Benny. Yeah.
Oh, God, you know, he was good.
Oh, very, yeah.
Yeah, and what a dancer. Wow.
Say, Fred, did you hear those open breaks?
Did I? They were the openest things I ever heard. But
yeah, he was good.
He was. Yes, I'll say he was. He was too doggone good. How do you think I felt knowing I was going to have to follow him this week? Anyway, thank you again, Jack.
Thank you ever so much.
Now, getting back to business, our sponsors, I believe, would like to have me at this point give you some brief outline of just what our show is going to be like on this series. Well, from my own deductions and after what the boys told me before I left for Europe and since then by wire, telephone, telegraph, radio, mental telepathy, and so forth, I would describe this program as a sort of variety, revusical, musical mélange of swing moments de luxe with embellishment. Presented against a background of humor, we hope, written by the scintillating intelligentsia and smothered in a symphonic atmosphere of stuff and blues and Charlie Butterworth.
Hello, Fred.
Hello, Charlie. What are you planning to do on this program?
Well, Fred, I want to be a big help. I thought you might be able to use me as a talent scout. You know, every big variety program has a talent scout.
Yes, Charlie, and you're just the fellow who can do it, too.
Oh, sure, Fred. I've been responsible for some of the biggest talent discoveries of recent years. Did I ever tell you how I discovered Marlene Dietrich?
No, not that I remember.
I didn't tell you how I discovered Marlene Dietrich? Well, that's a good one on me. I don't understand why. She's one of the biggest discoveries I've ever made. You've surely heard of Marlene Dietrich.
Why, of course, Charlie. Yes, of course.
Well, I was in the Foreign Legion. We were traipsing over the hot sands of Algeria. we were sniping riffs. But to get back to Marlene Dietrich, and how I'd love to, wouldn't you? Well, I hardly blame you. Say, you do know Marlene Dietrich?
I said yes, Charlie, yes.
You've never been in the Foreign Legion?
No.
Well, that'll help my story considerably. I'll never forget it. We'd been fighting for days and days, weeks. Say, I might even say months. Well, why not? Who's there to stop me? You don't know Marlene Dietrich?
Yes, yes, Charlie, I know.
Oh, the heat was intense. I could hardly stand it any longer. The sun got me. Well, when the sun gets in Algeria, it's sleepy time down south. I lay out there in a dead faint. Well, sort of a semi-conscious faint. You know, the kind when you know what's going on and you wish you could be there? Well, that's just the way I felt about Marlene Dietrich. I'd just about given up hope when one night a very strange thing happened. A pistol shot rang out in the night. Well, it pierced the silence like a pistol shot that rings out in the night, I guess. We all jumped up just as one man. I guess that was just because there was only one man there. And when it came to jumping up, he was a card. And in fact, they tell me of a time that he'd been lying flat on his back in the hot sun for 2 hours. Well, a pistol shot rang out. There he was. He never moved. Sunstroke. Well, we missed that fellow because you meet very few people on the desert, unless you go to Vienna or Rome. You must try it sometime, just you and the family. I'm sure you'll love it.
Yes, but Charlie, just a moment. What about Marlene and Dietrich?
Oh, I wouldn't advise it. Just take the family first.
That's all right. Don't go on, Charlie. You're hired. Do you know Mr. Ken Carpenter?
No, I don't.
Oh, Ken, I'd like you to meet our official talent scout on this program.
Welcome to the Packard Show.
Thank you. You know, I've been looking forward to appearing on this program with Fred Astaire. I'm a Fred Astaire fan. Or, as my friends quaintly put it, a Fred Astaire fan.
Charlie, I couldn't help but overhear that last remark.
Well, I shouldn't wonder. You're practically standing on my feet.
You're not as numb as I thought you were.
Thanks, Ken. That's very kind of you.
Oh, not at all.
Well, why not?
Well, nothing, just not at all.
Hey, I think you're taking the wrong attitude.
Now, let's get this thing straight. We'd better start all over again. You're Charlie Butterworth, and I'm Ken Carpenter.
Ken Carpenter? Oh, yes. Glad to know you.
But we just met.
Oh, I'm never too busy to say hello to an old friend.
Charlie, I know you must be a little nervous, but this can't go on forever. Won't you tell us something about yourself? Is Charles Butterworth your real name?
Well, the boys at school did call me Harold T. Harold.
Harold T. Harold. What's the T for?
Oh, just to break the monotony. By the way, Fred, when do I start, hunting for talent for tonight's program?
The sooner the better, Charlie. And, by the way, have you uncovered any talent for tonight's program yet?
No, not yet, Fred, but I will. I work fast. Who's that fellow over there?
Oh, that's Johnny Green.
That's rather an odd name, isn't it? I mustn't forget it. How do you do?
Greetings, Charlie.
I've always enjoyed your music, Mr.
Green. What do you think of in the springtime?
Oh, my option. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I take great pleasure in presenting a little talent discovery of mine, Johnny Green.
That's fine, Charlie, except he's already on the program.
Oh, don't mention it, Fred. It's no trouble at all. I'm glad to be of some help.
Thank you, Charlie. Thanks, Charlie, for discovering Johnny Green. I must admit, I'm crazy about Johnny's music. We've had a lot of fun making records together the past several years, and I'm certainly glad we're together on this program. Johnny's next number tonight is one of his own compositions being played for the first time on the air. It's called Yours Forever.
Every once in a while, a song refuses to die. It is born again in the whistling of errand boys, in the light humming of housewives going about their daily work, and in the cheerful, self-appreciative arias of men taking their morning showers. Such a song is the one Johnny Green has revived for us tonight in a new arrangement. You'll all remember from the Ziegfeld Follies, A Pretty Girl is Like a Melody. Fred Astaire has in store for you something of a dramatic treat. A strikingly effective piece from the pen of a hitherto unknown playwright, John R. Strouter, entitled Plain Susan Brown.
Just a minute, Ken.
Well, what's the trouble, Charlie?
Well, I hate to interrupt. Well, I guess I am interrupting. But the sound effects man hasn't shown up.
That's a big help.
I don't think it will be. There isn't a sound effect in the studio.
No sound effects?
No sound effects?
No sound effects.
Well, what are we going to do?
I can moo like a cow.
That's good, Charlie, but unfortunately, the scene takes place in the Paris apartment.
Couldn't a cow have been passing by? Oh, I guess it couldn't.
Say, Fred, here's an old taxi horn left over from some other program.
Well, let's try that.
All right.
Doesn't sound much like Paris, does it? Well, I guess we'll have to do the best we can. Charlie, will you help?
Certainly.
Will you take care of the sound effect as well as you can?
With that horn?
Yes, I mean, put it in wherever it seems fit. You know, use your imagination. And now, Ken, will you please set the scene?
Spring in Paris, in the elegant apartment of the charming Countess de Brienza. Her fiancé, played by Mr. Astaire, approaches the lovely Countess. His eyes and bearing show his devotion. It is the eve of their wedding. Sound effects by Charles Butterworth.
Tomorrow. 24 hours. Why, it hardly seems possible.
Oh, darling, I've dreamt of it for months. We shall pass on crew, then away to the mountains. Just you and I.
I hope the family arrive in time for the wedding. They promised to phone the moment the ship starts. isn't that the phone ringing? Yeah, it seems to have caught a little cold. Hello? Hello? Ah, welcome to France. How are you? Swell. It's Mother. It's great to hear your voice. Charlie, we didn't need that last honk.
Oh, I can spare it.
Yes, Mother? Oh, the wedding's tomorrow. Dinner tonight? We'd love it. Who? Oh, certainly, certainly. Isn't that fine? By all means, bring him along. We'll meet you at the Ritz. Goodbye, and au revoir. I'll hang up now. I say I'll hang up now. Charlie, I'm hanging up. Thanks.
I'm sorry, I was just trying to think of Johnny Green's last name.
Green, of course.
Yes, that's it. See, it comes so close to the Johnny, it just sort of confused me for a minute.
Well, please, please stay away. Darling, Mother says she couldn't wait to meet the charming Countess de Brienza.
I hope she'll like me.
Don't worry, darling. Oh, by the way, Mother says she met one of your father's best friends on the ship. He's coming along, too. He's very anxious to see you.
Oh.
Well, what's the matter, dear?
Oh, nothing.
Oh, but something is the matter. You went white.
Oh, not a thing. Just a slight buzzing in my head. I feel a little faint.
I don't wonder with that going on your head.
Oh, darling, do you mind if I don't go out tonight?
Well, I'd be disappointed. The family's been looking forward so much to meeting you. Tell you what, I'll run out and get dressed. Then if you still feel jittery, we'll call it off.
All right, dear.
Goodbye, darling. What's the matter with this door, anyway? So long, dear. Be back in a jiffy. I'm going out the door, Charlie, the bottom of the page.
Oh, it's a trap door.
Oh, I knew it would happen. I couldn't keep up this pretense. Oh, what a fool I've been. I know what I'll do. Why should I ruin his life? Why'd I put that revolver? Here it is. This is the only way out. I'll pull on the trigger and...
What's that? What's that? I thought I heard a shot. Mary. Mary, darling, are you hurt?
No.
Well, what happened?
I missed.
Oh, but why, darling?
Yeah, I like a happy ending.
Charlie, I'm reading the script, not talking to you. But why, Mary, on the eve of our wedding?
Well, dear, you might as well know it now. I tried to kill myself. I'm not Countess de Brienza. I'm just plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, Missouri.
Why, that's marvelous. That's wonderful news.
You don't care?
Care not a hoot. I like you better as plain Susan Brown.
Oh, darling, thank you. Oh, you make it so wonderful to be alive with the sun streaming through the windows. Bees buzzing. The birds singing their hearts out.
What, in all this traffic?
Oh, darling, I'm so ashamed.
Oh, stop it, silly. Kiss me.
All right, dear. But this time I'll kiss you for the first time, not as a celebrated Countess of Brienza, but as plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, M.O.
How did you say you're going to kiss her?
Charlie, as plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, M.O.
Okay, go ahead.
Darling.
Thank you for listening to WRVO Online. Please note that due to copyright issues, WRVO is unable to stream portions of its programming between 1 a.m. and 7 a.m. during the Olympics. You can refer to our website for the specific outage times. Our overnight programming returns to its regular schedule on August 30th. Please remember to support the programming you listen to by making a pledge to WRVO.
Oh, but why, darling?
Yeah, I like a happy ending.
Charlie, I'm reading the script, not talking to you. But why, Mary, on the eve of our wedding?
Well, dear, you might as well know it now. I tried to kill myself. I'm not Countess of Brienza. I'm just plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, Missouri.
Why, that's marvelous. That's wonderful news.
You don't care?
Care not a hoot. I like you better as plain Susan Brown.
Oh, darling, thank you. Oh, you make it so wonderful to be alive with the sun streaming through the windows, the bees buzzing. The birds singing their hearts out.
What, in all this traffic?
Oh, darling, I'm so ashamed.
Oh, stop it, silly. Kiss me.
All right, dear. But this time I'll kiss you for the first time, not as a celebrated Countess of Brienza, but as plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, M.O.
How did you say you're going to kiss her?
Charlie, as plain Susan Brown of St. Louis, M.O.
Okay, go ahead.
Darling.
Ah, here's the place. Oh, gosh, I can't even stand on my own feet.
Hold it, everybody, just a minute.
Well, what is it, young man? What can I do for you?
good morning. Good morning, may I come in?
But this is a dancing school and we're busy. What is it you want?
I want to be a dancer. All the world loves a dancer. For years, they've laughed at me when I approached the floor.
This class is for advanced pupils, my boy. The beginner's class meets on Wednesday.
Oh, let me try it just once, please, will you? Now, look, look. Slippery. I can do better than that.
Oh, it's no use. You're impossible. We only take pupils until promised. You should have been a truck driver.
Oh, don't say it, lady. That's what I am.
Well, I'm afraid we couldn't teach you a thing.
Oh, please, teacher, teach me something. Nice teacher, teach me something. I'm as awkward as a camel. That's not the worst. My 2 feet haven't met yet, but I'll be teacher's pet yet, cause I'm going to learn to dance or burst.
Thing yet.
Nothing's impossible I have found, for when my chin is on the ground, I pick myself up and dust myself off and start all over again. Can't lose my confidence if I slip. I'm grateful for a pleasant trip. I pick myself up, dust myself off and start all over again. I'll work like a soul inspired till the battle of the day is won. Though I'm sick and tired, I will stick till the job is done. When I remember the famous men who had to fall to rise again, I take a deep breath, pick myself up, dust myself off, and start all over again.
You get yourself assured if you're in dirty gray. You learn my easy things if you're courageous and brave.
To feel the strength I want to, I must hang on to your hand. Maybe by the time I'm 50, I'll get up and do a nifty.
How are we doing, fellas?
Before we launch the second half of the Packard Hour, we have the pleasure to bring you from Detroit from Green opens the second half of the Packard Hour, starring Fred Astaire with Stomping at the Savoy. In these days, when you get three feature pictures, a major preview, a newsreel, bank night, and a small tube of suntan oil with every ticket, it's pretty hard to dig up something new in the entertainment world. But from the gleam on his face, I think our distinguished talent scout, Mr. Butterworth, has already unearthed something pretty startling.
Yes, Ken. Fortunately, I've just come back from abroad where I combed the seven continents. England, France, Albany, Albania, Russia. I brought back just the right man.
Well, that's a real round-the-world search, Charlie. Where did you finally find him?
Find who?
Well, the man we're talking about.
Oh, him. Where did you find him?
Charlie, I didn't find him.
Oh, he's still lost. Have you tried a searching party?
Now, look. You said you went around the world searching for a man to fill this spot on the program. Where did you find him?
Over there among the sound effects.
Some scout.
Oh, yes, he's a great scout. He'll lend dignity to this program.
Well, what is it?
Surely you've heard of that distinguished critic of the cinema, Eddie Moran. He's going to preview a movie for us.
Yeah, but where is he now?
I don't know. I only discovered him.
I see. Well, I suppose he'll turn up pretty soon. While we're waiting, suppose... Well, this movie critic, or whoever he is, the one you went to the ends of the earth to find, England, France, Russia.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Did you have a nice trip?
I give up. You're a great help. What am I supposed to do? Johnny, have you got any music?
Oh, Ken. Excuse me, you should. You'll see you won't. I'm here till I came already, see me? With my 3 hot dates I had in front of the post office. With you 2 dates I was, so I was late. So now I'm here, I came already, see me?
What?
Oh. What's with my sweetheart? I'm here, so I came already, see me? To have dates with you, I was late. So now I'm here, I came already, see me?
I know. You had a date with your sweetheart.
Huh?
Well, you're
traveling,
you're late, and now you're here.
So I came already. With my sweetheart.
Now, wait a minute. Don't start that. What are you talking about?
English I'm talking about.
Well, I don't understand.
Then, Betty, you should listen. Dumb like you are, I shouldn't be to me.
Who's dumb?
I am. You'll see I will.
You mean they collided?
Huh?
They collided.
Nobody saw you. So look. Well, pretty soon was punching, scratching, fighting they were.
Who was punching, scratching, and fighting?
My sweetheart and the other lady, she will, they did.
Eddie,
with all kinds
Lawrence,
of...
You mean that your sweetheart and this other lady were actually engaged in fisticuffs?
No, fighting they were.
Eddie,
so look,
Eddie, I'm ashamed of you.
Me too.
It's
so look,
disgraceful you allowing yourself to become a spectator to this unladylike demeanor.
What did you say?
It doesn't matter. What have you planned for us this evening?
Oh, tonight. Well, tonight was when my sweetheart dates. I should have
him
to post.
Hold on. I mean, as our Hollywood columnist, what have you in store for?
Oh, movies I saw. You should see I saw.
Oh, you're going to review a movie.
That's what I will.
That should be quite interesting. Tell us about it.
Well, was the picture should open up, it did. And a boy and a girl, they were there because she should be in love. They were. So he kissed him and she kissed her. So what? So he went away because he was so happy. He was, which made her cry. So afterwards, another man came. Was like her father, he should be.
Oh, you mean paternal.
That's okay. So look. And there was a lot of talk. Anybody should feel sad because they were so happy. And pretty soon came an aeroplane with all kinds of girls dancing. They had, they will, they did. Because the girl went away then because she liked him so much. It showed. So pretty soon they both got killed, and that was the finish. So I'm here, so I came already. See me?
Yeah. It must have been quite an interesting picture.
I think so.
What was the name of that epic?
Mr. Deeds Goes to Town.
Yeah. One of the advantages of radio is that we don't have to wait while the scenery is shifted, the principals change costumes, and the stage is flooded with appropriately romantic lighting. All we need is a little imagination, a Jerome Kern score, and Fred Astaire singing The Way You Look Tonight.
I will feel a glow just thinking of you and the way you look tonight. Oh, but you're lovely, with your smile so warm and your cheeks so soft. There is nothing for me but to love you just the way you look tonight. With each word, your tenderness grows, tearing my fear apart. And that laugh that wrinkles your nose touches my foolish heart. Lovely, never, never change. Keep that breathless charm, or won't you please arrange it, 'cause I love you just the way you look tonight.
Astaire's great new picture, Swing Time, may now be playing in your neighborhood. When you see it, you will not only enjoy it thoroughly, but you may also find out how you may win a brand new Packard 6 in an easy and exciting contest. If you're unable to get the contest blanks at your local theater, your nearest Packard dealer or distributor has them for you. There is no obligation. And now we have a pleasant surprise for you. Those of you who heard last week's program remember one of our most charming guests, Miss Francia White. She made such a hit with the audience, we've asked her to come back for a return engagement. Miss Francia White. As her first number, Miss White has chosen a role that suits her very perfectly, that of the youthful and vivacious Juliet in Gounod's version of the ballroom scene in Romeo and Juliet.
To sing for you one of my favorites, One Kiss, from Sigmund Romberg's The New Moon. Of old-fashioned girls, you'll find very few. Our ideal
but know how I am wanting you. Ever wondering if all my dreams come true.
Fred Astaire.
I'm sure a great many people know what Bojangles, but for those who do not, what Bojangles means, but for those who do not, it is the nickname for that certain colored gentleman, dynamite dancer, Bill Robinson. This Jerome Kern number is also from our picture Swing Time, and once again, I'm afraid it will be impossible for me to give you the same conception here on the air that I use in the picture, but no matter how it is done, I can't help thinking of Bill. This is not an impersonation of him, but the idea was most certainly inspired by that one and only Bojangles, Bill Robinson.
Noisy side streets of New York's Harlem, born of the torpid breezes that swirl through its crowded back alleys and fire escapes, comes a rumor that starts every heart beating faster in Rhythm Town.
Bojangles is back in town.
Yes, sir, that old single strut coming right down Lenox Avenue.
Entrancing business is what they call the dancing business. When there's a beat up on the street, brother, you go and bet all your dough. Sister, you know that ain't no one but Bo. Oh, oh, Bojangles of Harlem, you dance such hot stuff. Young folks love you in Harlem. They say you got the tough guys from the out of Peru. They sit trucking out of the rooms, oh, oh, Bojangles of Harlem. The whole town's at your heels. Leaves things they're flat, Smith things they're mean, running like rats, going astray, throw those long legs away.
Bojangles of Harlem, you dancers, hot stuff. Young folks love you in Harlem. They say you've got stuff.
Bojangles of Harlem, you dancers, hot stuff.
dealers everywhere invite you in a most cordial and friendly manner to see the four sensational new Packards at your nearest showroom without the slightest obligation on your part. You'll enjoy your visit, because if your Packard dealer isn't already one of your friends, we're certain he will be after you've met him. You'll find him courteous, helpful, and eager to answer all your questions. Let him explain how easy it is to buy a Packard, how easy it is to own a Packard. Say yes when he asks you to drive a Packard. And after you've put it through a thorough and thoughtful test, see if you'll ever be satisfied until you get the plus of a Packard. As the Packard hour whirls away its last few seconds, Johnny Green's music gives you a preview of Fred Astaire's featured musical number in next week's Packard Hour, Top Hat, White Tie, and Tails. And with Fred Astaire next week, more Charlie Butterworth, more Johnny Green music, and a dramatic treat postponed from this week, the world-famous Abbey Players. Entertainment gathered together for your pleasure by Packard, makers of America's finest motor cars. Until then, ask the man who owns one.
Ladies and gentlemen, I've had a lot of fun on this program this evening, and I hope you have too.
That goes double. Fred, I want to tell you how much I enjoy being on this program with you. And, you know, the fellow with the orchestra?
Look, Charlie, that's me, Johnny Green. G-R-E-E-N.
Oh, two E's. That's what threw me off. I'm sorry. Well, good night, Fred. Good night, Mr. You know, that's a swell orchestra you've got. Good night, Fred. Good night, boys.
Good night, Charlie. See you next Tuesday.
This program originated in the NBC studios in Hollywood. This is the Red Network of the National Broadcasting Company.